Hello and welcome back to From the Workshop, host Brandon Hart, NerdLair, NimbleLink. All right, you guys know the deal by now. So this time I kind of want to focus on the idea that cellular is different from other ways of sending data. We kind of covered that. We understand that cellular is a little bit different, but kind of specifically billing-wise, money-wise, one of the things people always like to talk about when it comes to cellular is, yeah, but then I'm going to have to pay a monthly fee, and that's going to get costly, that's going to get expensive. May or may not be, depends on your situation, depends on your use case, depends on what type of data you're sending and that kind of thing. But there are ways to keep your data utilization down, and therefore the costs associated with using that data down as well. And that's what I want to kind of focus on this time. So, let's just jump right in. So first off, one of the things to note is that there are multiple protocols which can be utilized. So on the transport protocol side, a lot of you are already going to be familiar with this, but there are two main transport protocols. There's TCP and there's UDP. Those are very, very different in kind of what they do, how they work, what is implied when you pick one of those to choose from. So first of all, TCP, which is the most common, it's pretty much what the internet is based on. TCP is everywhere. TCP IP, you might hear it called. So TCP is inherently reliable, meaning it is going to ensure that if you send data over the internet, the other side will say, hey, I'm ready, send your data. Then you send your data, and the other side said, I've got your data, send your next one, and then that kind of thing. So there's a lot of chatter, there's a lot of extra stuff going on. I kind of consider that overhead, extra stuff. There's a big header associated with all the packets. There's a lot of things going on besides just your data being sent. But it ensures that it gets to the other side. So if you have a use case where sending your data, your data has to get to the other end. Every single packet has to get there. It always has to make it. You have to ensure that it'll get there. TCP is the one for you. And you're going to pay a little bit more because you're going to be paying for extra handshaking and reliability, but it's worth it for you. For the rest of us who are just sending sensor data or sending heartbeats or sending things like that, stick with UDP. And we're going to get into this a little bit more, but UDP has far less overhead, far less baggage, far less in the header. So UDP is less reliable because UDP doesn't have that whole handshaking back and forth, did you get it, yes I got it, send the next one kind of thing. But it is also far lighter weight. So when you send your data, your payload is what you're paying for far more than the actual headers and overhead associated with it. So that's kind of the premise. So we're going to get into some illustrations of what this looks like here in just a second, but I kind of also want to talk about what is used over these transport protocols, the application protocols that are utilized. Again, sort of associated with TCP, you have HTTP or HTTPS. Very common. This is, REST APIs, things like that use HTTP and HTTPS. It uses TCP. It has additional stuff that it puts in the header. It also is very heavyweight as well. Really easy to use. And again, the internet is kind of based on HTTP. When you type in a URL for a website, it starts with HTTP or HTTPS. And then it's, google.com or whatever. So very common, very easily understood, and where a lot of the developers start. However, there are alternatives to HTTP. For instance, on the TCP side, if you want to stick with TCP, there's also MQTT, which is far lighter weight. Still uses TCP, so it's still going to be a little bit heavy because of that, but MQTT shrinks all of the headers and the information down, still in the HTTP format, still kind of REST type of format, but is much lighter weight and much smaller. I'm kind of rushing through this part because I want to get to the rest. UDP, there's a new application protocol called Constrained Application Protocol, COAP for short. And COAP, it does the same type of HTTP, your gets, your posts, and things like that, just like MQTT does, but it does it over UDP. So not only is it very lightweight on its own, but it is using UDP as well. And it has some sort of inherent handshaking built into it. So this is kind of the best, smallest, most lightweight combination right here. This is pretty good. This is way overkill. So let's get into what that means and kind of illustrate that a little bit. So I just came up with this a few minutes ago, so bear with me. Here we have our packet. So this is the packet we're going to be sending, okay? And to go in our packet, we have some data, okay? So we've got some data that's gonna go in our packet here. All right, so this is a UDP packet. So you notice it's relatively small. There's not a lot of extra stuff in here that's clogging it up. So pretty much if you wanted to send some data, you put your data in your packet, and then off it goes. Not a lot of extra stuff going on. You just put your data in the packet, send it off UDP style, and there it is. So that's UDP. On the other side, you have TCP. and TCP, let's just label these real quick. So here's your UDP, here's your TCP. Okay, so with TCP, first of all, you'll notice it's much bigger. But on the kind of the trade-off here though is with TCP, you got a whole lot of extra overhead. So a whole lot of extra stuff is going to go into that header. So even though it's bigger, even though there's more here in terms of size that you're going to have to pay for to transport across the across the internet, you've got a lot of that taken up with the header. And even more if you're using something like HTTP or HTTPS. So now you've got some more stuff that's in the amount of data that you're going to be paying for. So guess what? After it's all said and done, you still have just as much room in here, but you're paying for a whole lot more. So you put your data in there in the little bit of space that's left, and you're going to pay for this whole thing here. So essentially, you're paying for a lot more for the TCP and HTTP overhead than you are for your actual data as you're sending it through. On the other side, with UDP, you're pretty much paying for your data. A little bit of packaging, a little bit of overhead, but not nearly as much as there is on the TCP side. So I think that that metaphor, that analogy seems to hold up. It's like having these different packages. If you want to pay more for your actual payload than for all the extra overhead and stuff, baggage associated with it, UDP does that. It's your choice. It's your winner. However, if it absolutely positively has to get there, yes, I stole that line, then TCP will do that for you, but at the cost of a whole bunch of extra stuff, extra overhead, extra heavy weight things, just to be able to get that same amount of data where it's going. Okay, UDP, TCP. So let's talk about something else. First of all, regardless of which way you go, and we'll just say we're going to go UDP, regardless of which way you go, there are some other ways you can optimize. So say you have to go TCP or you have to go UDP, that's it, that's the only way you have. There are still some other things you can do to optimize the amount of data or how often you're sending it. One thing you can do is you can store in forward. So let's say you're just sending a sensor value, a temperature value, and that's it. That's your whole solution is just a temperature monitoring solution. What you would normally do is you get a temperature reading, pop it in there, off it goes, right? So you've sent it out. But the problem is you're going to pay for the overhead associated with whether it's TCP, UDP, whatever, for that entire packet. However, what you could do instead is hold on to that data. So one temperature reading, another 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 temperature reading. You get the idea. And then once you have enough data, or after so much time, put all of those temperature readings together, send them off, same exact overhead as if you just sent one, send that off, you pay less because you're optimizing the amount of, your packet sizes and the amount of payload that's actually in each one of those packets that you're going to have to pay for to transport across the cellular network. Cool. Another idea is, let's say, same solution, temperature sensing solution. What you're really worried about is the temperature too low or is the temperature too high? So here is a perfectly fine temperature reading. It's perfectly fine. Do we really need this information? Not really. Don't need that one. Here's another temperature reading. Temperature is perfectly fine. Nothing wrong with the temperature. We don't need to send that. Here's another one. Temperature is a little bit higher than it was before, but it's still well within the acceptable means or acceptable levels. We're good. Here's another temperature reading. Okay, now we're getting a little bit close. It's getting a little bit high. This is starting to be a little bit troublesome. We're gonna hang on to the fact that that temperature is starting to trend up a little bit, but this is still within the acceptable levels, so we're good. Okay, now this has just crossed the threshold. This temperature right here is too high. We need to put that in the packet. We need to send that off immediately. That is gone. Now we've got that temperature data and we are aware that there's an actual problem. This is processing at the edge. So your device is getting the temperature readings. It's taking a look at the temperature data. If that temperature were to continue to sort of trend upward but not reach the threshold, maybe it would say, okay, I'm going to go ahead and send the temperature data, or I'm going to send an alert so that that information is available to the users, to the system. Rather than sending all the temperature data that doesn't really do you any good, doesn't provide any information, all you really need to know, is it too low, is it too high? So that's another way you can optimize for data. The last thing is exception reporting. It's very similar to the sort of processing at the edge, but instead of sending the actual data, maybe you just send an alert. And so if something is happening that is a bad thing, something's out of the threshold, out of the acceptable range, you're just sending an alert saying, hey, something's wrong, or you're sending an alert that says, hey, temperature is too high. So very similar to processing at the edge, but this is more reporting by exception rather than reporting at predetermined intervals, or reporting the data itself over time, or storing and forwarding that data, that kind of thing. You don't need to send data across the cellular network unless there's some actual information that is needed. So I hope that was helpful. Basically, the idea is that unlike traditional wireline and Wi-Fi and other types of networks that exist out there and have existed for a long time, cellular has a little bit of a different constraint, a little bit of a different thought process on how much data you can send and what you're going to pay for that data as well. So by optimizing your transport, optimizing your application protocols, optimizing when and if you even send data in the first place, you can keep those costs down. Cellular becomes very, very affordable and very reliable, very available, and becomes potentially the best solution for you in cases it wouldn't have otherwise been. So there you go. There's a top tip for you. So anyway, this is from the workshop. And we'd love if you would subscribe to the channel so that you don't miss the next riveting episode of From the Workshop for all your tips for cellular, for SkyWire development, and so on. Until next time, Brandon Hart from the Workshop. Subscribe, leave comments, and we thank you very much. See you then.